Pedro Rios from AFSC had sent all of the artists a copy of like just the court case. So it goes down and it breaks everything down. And I remember reading the case, and what really stood out to me was when they first apprehended him, one of the agents said he didn't behave like a typical alien. He wasn't aggressive, but he kept looking at them straight in their eyes. Here's a person that's not behaving in the typical way because he doesn't have his head down, because he's not like really afraid of like what they're, not really, not that he's not afraid, I'm sure he was, but you know, he held his cool, he was calm about it and was looking at them straight in the eye. They're expecting him to like have his head down in shame, or they're expecting him to react in this typical manner. And because he didn't, that is what I feel like sparked everything.
Mi nombre es Maria Puga, esposa de Anastasio Hernández. Yo supe del proyecto del mural a través de Pedro Ríos. Es el director del Comité de Amigos Americanos. Él me lo comentó. Después pues tuvimos una reunión con el maestro Ochoa. Lo platicamos y pues a mí me, pues sí, me gustó mucho la idea y lo estuvimos platicando ahí, las ideas de ellos, porque pues yo, como siempre les comenté, no sé mucho de arte de la pintura. El caso estaba cuando se empezó el mural, estábamos que se había puesto una queja en la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos. Y ahorita el caso ya están revisando los casos, estamos esperando respuesta del gobierno. Hubo varios testigos muy importantes, entonces pienso yo que pronto vamos a encontrar la justicia.
But she really is a champion and a warrior now. And the battle that she's fighting is huge. It's a huge battle. And it's not just for her, it's all the children, all the migrants, everybody that's come before her. And she carries that on her shoulders. She carries all of that weight. And it's a big weight that she carries. The image of the father and the little girl that drowned, that was some image that popped up when we were in class. Last summer, and we really battled very hard with that image because it was so graphic and it was so powerful, and we were cry and we were argue like, no, we won't want it on there, no, we don't think it's too painful. And we finally decided to put it in there.
You're sitting in a room and you're staring at this image for like hours, and it does affect you, but at the same time, you also want to take that image and make it into something beautiful. When I talked to Victor about it, I'm like, hey, like, I really want to include this image, because at the time, even I was looking away from it. I purposely didn't look at the photo, and I'm like, no, this, I can't see that. Like, this is a child, a 2-year-old. But ultimately what guided my decision to include it was Victor had invited us to meet with Maria Puga, and he kind of mentioned it to her, like, oh, she's thinking about including this on the mural, like, what are your thoughts? And she told me this story that will stay with me forever. She knew the video existed, and she knew that it was on TV. Whenever they would talk about the case, she would turn it off, and she didn't see the video for a whole year.
Te digo, al principio me llené mucho de coraje, de rabia, y hubo el primer año que yo pues no hice nada, estaba como con mi duelo, pero ya Con el tiempo, te digo, empecé a agarrar más fuerzas y más, quería gritarlo, que todo el mundo supiera lo que había pasado, que todo el mundo supiera lo que le habían hecho a mi esposo.
She decided to take the video and tour high schools in San Diego and have students watch it. Because she didn't want people to forget, like, this is the brutality that my husband faced. Like, this is what those agents did to him. And she's like, no, mija, like, you need to, like, include these images. People cannot forget that these horrific events happened, that people are continuing to perish. One of the students had said, like, oh, like, what if you painted them living also? And they are. There is, on the Maria side, there is the little girl. She's painted there with the other children. And we also have their spirits ascending, like holding hands and being birthed through corn. So there is a balance of like that harsh reality, but also that glimmer of hope.
I'm sitting there painting these happy images of these children, and they remind me of like my family members and my little cousins, and but they're no longer alive. They're no longer with us. They weren't treated fairly, which led to their deaths. So that reality was a lot to really think about. And it was it's a very tragic thing to be focused on for a long period of time.
After reading the case, you realize like this one bottle of water and these words that are lost in translation is what ultimately just piss these agents off, because he's carrying this water. They asked him to throw it away. They're speaking to him in English. So he translated it as like, get rid of the water. So he uncaps it and pours the water out. Well, this enrages the agent, because he's thinking like, oh, this guy's being funny. He's trying to be insubordinate, or, you know, he's not complying.
The images really came from Maria, because her children, until in the very last couple weeks, they didn't want to participate. They didn't want anything to do with the mural. They didn't want to be photographed. They didn't want to be interviewed. And that's things that Maria had told me. And this is for us, like being out here and doing this joyously. I had to always remember, this is not happiness for them. This is their tragedy. And it's in display, like, to the whole world what happened to them. So always being very respectful about how we address Maria, asking her permission, taking her into account anytime there was something that needed to be said, was like, for me, that was huge, huge for me. To make sure that she was blessing what was happening here.
And we decided to include that, his hand pouring out the water. The water that's pouring from his hand has like the father and daughter that drowned, but it also runs through and wraps around to like the healing part, the smoke that comes from the healing from the women burning copal. There's like all these like elements that just flow and wrap around the mural. And most importantly, like the water also connects the corn. And that's where the spirit of the father and daughter come from also. So it's like, in that sense, like water has that ability to like heal, but it also has that ability to do the opposite.
Victor offered me to assist in painting portraits, specifically at first the portraits of the children who are featured on what's the back of the mural. So it's sort of like an altar, like from Dia de los Muertos. We have that symbolism of the marigolds surrounding the children. And right below the children, there is a papel picado of, I believe it's the eternal flame that's sort of turning into the marigold petals. And so it's supposed to represent that they're going on into sort of the afterlife. And we're honoring them in this way to help guide them to the afterlife.
Pues la primera vez que fui a visitar el mural, pues sí, me quedé como porque al principio yo no vine, ya iba un poco de avance y cuando fui pues sí, me quedé como muy impresionada de ver cómo estaba quedando y fue algo muy, así, unos sentimientos muy encontrados. Y como al principio yo lo miraba como dije, es un proyecto, no me imaginaba que se iba como a realizar, como lo miras ahorita que está por el mural, entonces por eso me emocionó mucho.
¿Qué efecto ha habido en su vida la existencia de este mural?
El efecto que ha habido en mi vida de este mural ha sido varios, como te estaba comentando hace ratito, es saber que está ahí Anastasio y cada que pasas por ahí, o sea, volteas seguido, yo vengo a estar ahí, y no sé, son muchas emociones que te digo que me dan, muchas veces mucha tristeza de pensar en lo que pasó y porque está ahí mi esposo, porque está ahí su imagen. Entonces te digo, sí, son muchas cosas cambiaron. El mural tiene varias cosas que me impactan, pero una de las que más, yo siempre he dicho, es donde está tirado mi esposo rodeado de los oficiales. Esa imagen, o sea, la miro y te recuerdas todo lo que pasó, como ahorita precisamente que lo miré, o sea, mirar a mi esposo que como está ahí sin ropa, o sea, te quedas, hasta su ropa le quitaron, o sea, qué inhumanos de esas personas. Entonces digo, esa imagen a mí me impacta mucho así cuando la miro. No me molestó porque creo esa imagen tenía que estar ahí porque es realmente lo que pasó. Entonces te digo, hubo una imagen que sí, yo no sé si te diste cuenta que yo, la familia no la aprobó. Era una imagen donde mi esposo estaba prácticamente pues muerto. Y esa imagen no la quisimos ahí porque era una de mis hijas principalmente, también uno de mis cuñados me dijo mi hija, la segunda, yo trabajo por ahí cerca, dijo, y cada que yo pase, dijo, yo no quiero ver así a mi papá. Entonces dije, estaba muy fuerte para que esa imagen estuviera ahí, o sea, pero esa imagen donde está con rodeo de los oficiales, pues sí, esa imagen pues tenía que estar, te digo. Anastasio era una persona, yo conocí a Anastasio, te voy a hablar un poquito de cómo, porque yo lo describo de que era un gran ser humano. Cuando yo llegué recién a este país, llegué a la casa de Anastasio. Anastasio era una persona tan amable, tan te ayudaba. Yo recuerdo que me decía, coma abuelita, ándele, coma, está cansada o así. Y siempre ha sido así, él era así con la gente, él, por eso tenía muchas amistades. Entonces como ser humano, digo, pues como esposo, pues él era una persona que siempre pensaba en mí, primero en mí, todo el tiempo, tú primero, siempre pensaba en mí. Y como padre, pues él era un gran padre. Él le gustaban mucho sus hijos, o sea, él le encantaban mucho los niños. Por eso tuvimos, yo creo, tantos, ¿verdad? Pero él era un gran padre. Él era, quería mucho a sus hijos. Él y sus hijos, pues igual a él.
So when he was initially apprehended, he was with his brother. And his brother fell because they were running. His brother fell, and Anastasio goes back to help pick him up. And that's when that agent catches up to him.
Era un gran ser humano, Anastasio. Eso es lo que yo te lo describo. Te oí mucha gente. Por eso, pues, tanto nos dolió y hasta la fecha, lo siguen extrañando. Yo tengo una foto a un lado de mi cama y siempre estoy platicando con él, así. Y todavía, te digo, han pasado ya, va a ser 11 años y es día de que digo, ¿por qué pasó esto? O sea, ¿por qué de un día para otro se fue?
I hope that this kind of fuels, like this in some way kind of fuels the case and kind of ignites and brings awareness, like that we need to work harder. We need to stand with our brothers and sisters, remember where we came from, because we can't continue doing this to people anymore. It's destroyed all of their lives.
Entonces el mural ayuda mucho, ha ayudado mucho a llamar más la atención. Son muchas cosas, te digo, entonces para mí siempre he dicho esto, y eso una manera de denunciar, yo siempre he dicho, el mural para mí es como una denuncia, de decir, aquí en la frontera pasó esto, este caso, y muchos casos, no más el de Anastasio, entonces para mí el mural siempre, yo he dicho que es algo de son las denuncias de que lo que pasa en nuestra frontera.
So I know that the Biden administration now is, they're transporting people from like different detention centers from different border towns. So, for example, they're taking immigrants from Texas and flying them over to San Diego, and then they're deporting them from that port of entry into a whole different part of Mexico where they have no family, they have no relationship to that area. Those type of tactics are just like new ways in which like the government is trying to deter immigration for people that in reality are seeking asylum, from countries that are where their governments aren't stable. And oftentimes it's the United States that makes these countries unstable, that have intervened into their government. We don't want people to forget about these atrocities. Like these are still happening now under the Biden, under the Biden administration, children are still being locked in cages. The only thing that's changed is it's like now a migrant detention center where the name. So it's like using these euphemisms in order to like soften how the media portrays the administration.
We hear about border brutalities all the time, but we don't hear about the specific cases and really dig into what those people's families went through after the tragedy. And how that affects the family, the trauma that causes for them. So I think it's important that we raise awareness for those individuals and bring to light the issue at the border.
Falta, fíjate, falta mucho por hacer, porque es como te digo, podemos que el caso de Anastasio lleguemos a encontrar justicia, pero hay muchos casos, entonces es seguir presionando, no dar ni un paso atrás, porque hay muchos casos que resolver. Y lo más importante, como digo, para que ya no haya otras familias sufriendo como yo he estado sufriendo, que mis mis hijos en su padre. O sea, yo tengo un hijo de 22 años que él no supera. Él está muy dañado, mi hijo. Y les hace falta su padre. Y no es justo que vengan unas personas y te arrebaten la vida nomás porque sí, sin pensar en que tienes una familia. Ellos no pensaron que Anastasio tiene una familia, que tenía 5 hijos esperándolo y una esposa. Sus padres, sus hermanos. Anastasio era de una familia, o sea, era un ser humano, digo, que hasta la fecha se extraña. Mira, yo siempre a las personas, a las familias que han pasado por lo que yo he pasado, porque he platicado con varias personas que les han pasado estos casos, yo siempre les he dicho que tienen que luchar por justicia para sus seres queridos. Sé que es muy difícil y muchas de las veces no creen en la justicia. Al principio hubo algunas mamás que me dijeron, si con tu esposo no se hizo justicia, ¿qué podemos esperar nosotros? Que haya evidencia. Le digo, pero es que tenemos que insistir, le digo, tenemos que seguir presionando hasta lo último. Entonces yo siempre he dicho, mi consejo para todas las familias que han pasado por eso, que tienen que denunciar y no cansarse, porque la denuncia es como podemos terminar con todo esto, con todas estas violencias que pasan en la frontera. Entonces, es denunciar. Mira, yo encuentro la fuerza para seguir luchando, una por mis hijos, por mi esposo, porque, como te digo, él no merecía lo que le hicieron. Esto que le hicieron a él fue algo tan horrible. Esa muerte que le dieron a él, o sea, lo torturaron. Yo antes no estaba organizada. Esa también fue una de las cosas, de que cuando no estás organizado, estás fuera de todo esto. Hasta que no te pasa, te das cuenta de todo lo que está pasando. Entonces, digo, yo me empecé a organizar, a involucrarme más en todo esto. Y es como te das cuenta de tantas injusticias, tantas cosas que hay. Entonces, te digo, siempre es bueno que la comunidad conozca de todo lo que pasa y así, pues, apoyarnos entre todos.